Look, just like the Tea Party caused a split within the Republican Party, Wall Street is creating, and has been for a long time, creating that split with the Democratic Party. We have people like Cory Booker who think that it's okay, or Rahm Emanuel, to be the best buddies with Wall Street hustlers and true populists like Bill de Blasio. Well, he recognizes that there has to be a new image of the Democratic Party in order for it to be what they say they are. Joining me now to talk about this divide is Harold Meyerson. He's editor-at-large for The American Prospect. Harold, we've been talking about this last couple of days. Sometimes it's almost difficult to even tell a difference between what's going on with the Democrats and Republicans. When you have Manchin in Virginia, West Virginia, you've got Feinstein in California, you've got Schumer, you've got a whole host of Democrats that just have lost sight of the fact of what we built the, you know, what the Democrats, I'm not a Democrat, I say that again and again, I'm an independent, but on what that party built its legitimacy on.
That's right. I mean, the striking thing about the Democratic Party today is that it used to be a party that was fairly united on a left-of-center economic policy. I mean, that's why it got the New Deal, that's why it got the Great Society, and it was always divided on social issues, on rights of minorities, and on foreign policy. That's why you got the old Dixiecrat senators who were within the Democratic Party, and the splits over Vietnam. Today, it's kind of reversed. The white South has pretty much left the Democratic ranks almost altogether and joined the Republicans. There really aren't huge foreign policy differences, as there were, say, over Vietnam, within the Democratic Party. Where there are differences is on economics. I mean, there's a basic agreement on, we shouldn't have the sequester. The minimum wage should be raised. But really, the party for a couple of decades in particular has been the landing place for the old Rockefeller Wall Street Republicans who left the Republican Party because they couldn't stand how right-wing it had gotten on the civil rights and things like that. And they've kind of dominated economic policymaking. Robert Rubin and his proteges not only dominated the party's economic policy during Bill Clinton's presidency, but Obama appointed Rubin's proteges, and they're still there, to run economic policy during his presidency. And so there's been, from Washington, not really nearly enough regulation of Wall Street, not nearly enough progressive populist economics.
Well, you say not from Washington. State by state, I think we're seeing the same thing. Look,
we are.
Here, let's look at the Janet Yellen issue, Larry Summers, Janet Yellen, where you had the Democrats fighting over the fate of Wall Street kind of liberalism. I mean, you had, look at the Clintons. I mean, what role did Hillary take? Well, she really didn't take a role, really didn't say anything, stood silently on it. Bill Clinton comes in as in a defense of Summers. And all of a sudden, we start seeing this divide is getting more and more extreme. We forget that Bill Clinton invited all of this with Robert Rubin. And it happened, as you point out in your article, I love the article, What Divides Democrats. When you talk about, look, there was a 50-year transformation, began with the Lyndon Johnson signing the Civil Rights Act. You had Southern whites, as you've already pointed out, left the party. But what moved into there was you had liberal financial elites, social liberal financial elites that were turned off on the racial issue and the gender issues that they saw coming from the Republicans. And so all of a sudden they moved in and they've taken control, kind of, haven't they?
Yes, they have. And, you know, this parallels the fact that the financial sector has grown, way bigger than it used to be in taking control of the economy at large. So it's an ominous parallel development. Now, and as you said, and as I wrote in this piece, which is on the Prospect website, www.prospect.org, this was clear in the Summers-Yellen fight. However, we should be encouraged by the fact that Summers, didn't make it. That Yellen, who was backed by really left populist progressive Democratic senators like Sherrod Brown of Ohio and Elizabeth Warren of Massachusetts ultimately prevailed. And there's this complication with the position of the Clintons on this. I mean, it is true that Bill Clinton rode to the defense of Larry Summers, but he did it only after Summers withdrew. And what I take that to mean is that, you know, the Clintons are always pretty good at reading political signals. And, you know, they're not sure now which way the party is headed. I mean, Hillary is, you know, the Hillary Express is already beginning to move for 2016. There's stories on that in both the New York Times and the Washington Post today. But if she runs still surrounded by the Rubenistas, that may not go down so well in a lot of the Democratic Party base.
Harold, interesting. So, you heard Hillary a week or maybe it's 2 weeks ago talking all this populist dogma, almost as if she's trying to say, I'm a populist. We know that's not true. I mean, we know that Hillary Clinton is anything but a populist. She is simply an extension of Bill in so many ways. Now, you may disagree with that. That simply is my observation of it. And I think a lot of people would agree with me on that. But when you said she's not sure, I think that supports your idea. She's not sure. You know, have rank and file Democrats saying, you know, Wall Street has taken control of our party. Look, Harold, for the first time, I'm hearing more and more need a third party, not a Ralph Nader kind of party, but a real worker kind of party. You know, somebody that's out there that is charismatic enough to make something happen. I got to tell you something. I would not be worried if I were a Democrat looking to run in this next presidential cycle, if I was a viable Democrat. I wouldn't worry about the whole Clinton name and idea because it may be a liability.
Well, I don't know if it's a liability because I think there's this residual popularity, but I think there is a real base for someone like Elizabeth Warren if she chooses to run. Now, it may be that Hillary if Hillary runs, no one serious is going to run against her, but you know, the ideological space is certainly there. And I think, you know, here's where I might take issue with you. I think the Clintons have enough political sense to see if the ideological space is there. Maybe they should occupy it a little. And look, the base of the Democratic Party has changed since Bill Clinton was elected president. There are a lot more Latinos, and Latinos are a constituency that actually supports, you know, bigger government, more government services. The millennials are crazy in need of an activist government that, you know, engenders employment. So I think on economics, I think the Democrats, whatever happens, are going to have to run to the left of where that they were running in the 1990s on the economy. I think that's, they can do it, they have to do it, and there's a political advantage to doing it. And, you know, just to get back to Bill de Blasio, who you mentioned at the start, I mean, he came out of what was a left, you know, a left party, which doesn't run against Democrats, but which nudges them to the left. That's the Working Families Party in New York, which is a terrific example of what you're talking about. But in New York, New York has a law where, you know, a candidate's name can appear on the ballot line for more than one party, and so the Liberal Democrats end up on the Working Families Party.
What I loved about de Blasio is that, you know, he said, look, this is where I am. I'm going to stand behind it. His advisor said, yeah, it's time to stand behind it. You know, you are anti-corporate, anti-greed corporate. You're condemning the wrongdoings of big business. You feel like the financial sector is using its wealth in the wrong kind of way. We need to put money in the hands of the working poor in order to boost this economy, saying all those things. And then it was just a matter of weeks after that where I'm telling you, we heard Hillary Clinton talking a little bit like that. And do you think we read too much into the de Blasio election up in New York?
Well, it's possible. But I mean, you know, what's interesting is that, as you pointed out earlier, a lot of Democratic mayors have been the ones running to the right, from Rahm Emanuel to Cory Booker, at times, Antonio Villaraigosa, who recently completed his term as mayor of Los Angeles in terms of really going with financial sector policies and priorities on the privatization of schools and what have you. De Blasio really goes in the other direction. And I think a lot of this we have to watch at the city level, because at the city level is where you've gotten a real split between Democratic mayors inclined more to the financial sector and the political base of the party, minorities and unions, going the other way.
So as all this progresses, what do you think the field looks like for Democrats presidential-wise? Do you have any vision?
Yeah, well, I mean, Hillary is the 800-pound gorilla. If she runs, it is possible there won't be anyone to her left. If she doesn't run, I think you'd see a kind of corporate Democrat like Andrew Cuomo run, and you'd see someone like Elizabeth Warren run to his left, and there could be a real Donnybrook. Now, is anyone going to come in if Hillary runs and run to her left? I don't know. I mean, and I think part of the reason, those populist comments from her that you've referred to is to keep that from happening if she does run. So we'll see.
Yeah, we've heard a lot of that populism from Obama in the past, and I don't know that it's really been delivered. So it'll be an interesting development. Harold, thank you for joining me, okay?